This program is made possible by the partners and friends of Creflo Dollar Ministries.
So every time the devil speaks or says anything that's not lined up with the word, and think about it, he ain't gonna say nothing that's in line with the word. So every time he speaks, hold up the shield of faith. Don't fuss with him, don't argue with him, hold up the shield of faith. So if he comes and say you're gonna die, hold the shield of faith up and say, I will live and not die. If he comes and say you're gonna die of this cancer, say, no, I'm already healed. If he comes and say you'll be broke all your life, no, God has prospered me and I will prosper in every way. See, you have to know how to hold the shield up when the dark comes. But prayer people are getting ready to turn this thing back on. And you already know what's gonna happen when we start praying. Hallelujah, don't let me get back in my closet. Don't let me pray in the name of Jesus. And I am saying it is time for us to get back to prayer. He's still got some chairs he wants to fill up. He's still got some things to do.
I'm a world changer.
This is Changing Your World with Creflo Dollar. Now from the World Dome in College Park, Georgia, here's Pastor Dollar with today's message.
Ephesians chapter 6, we're talking about praying after the cross and what's the difference between prayer after the cross and before the cross. Well, now, please understand this statement. Nothing happens in the earth by God without somebody praying. Nothing happens in the earth by God without somebody praying it. Now, all that you have heard and all that you understand about grace and what grace has made available to us, the Bible says in the book of Peter, he says that we have all things that pertain to life and godliness. So everything we'll ever need has already been provided. Everything that we pray about has already been provided. You are the righteousness of God. You are already healed. You're already delivered. Everything that you'll ever need, every provision that you'll ever need, Jesus already provided it through his grace, his unmerited favor. But now the next question is, if Jesus has already provided it, and the Bible made it clear, he says he gave salvation to all men. But why is it that all men are not saved? If it's available to all men, why are they not all saved? Because all haven't responded in faith to receive what has already been given them and what has already been made available to them. Now, I'm telling you right now, prayer is that connection that opens the door to all that grace is made available. Prayer opens the door for the manifestations to come into your life. And without prayer, it's almost like this is a covenant promise here, that when you pray, things are going to take place. Not that your prayer is getting God to manufacture something. Your prayer is, in essence, providing the necessary permission or permit that heaven needs to cause it to manifest in your life. So what happens when we become more distracted by our trouble and our drama and our circumstances and situations, so distracted that we fail to pray? We're waiting to see if the manifestation is going to come. We back up and say, let's see what God's going to do. But when you're not praying, then there, heaven doesn't have the permit or the permission to release what grace has already made available to you. So again, this is what I want you to get in your spirit. Nothing happens in your life and on this earth without prayer. Nothing happens without prayer. So if you're waiting or wondering or asking how come this thing hadn't happened yet, I want you to remind yourself, I want you to look at yourself and say, have you prayed about it in the name of Jesus? See, we've been given the authority to pray in the name of Jesus. And when we pray in the name of Jesus, we give heaven the necessary permit. You know, restaurants need a permit before they can go into business. Certain builders need a permit before they can build something. Glory to God. Well, heaven needs a permit. You are the people with the authority, and heaven is not going to do anything without your permission or without your permit. Prayer is the permitting process by which heaven can show up with all of the finished works of Jesus Christ. If you understand that, say amen. Amen. We have understood in the past, and it is true, that prayer is communication with God. It absolutely is. Prayer then is really saying what God has already said in His Word. We're not just talking about praying a lot of foolish prayers, and I'll show you some foolish prayers today, but we're talking about knowing the Word of God, and we're talking about praying what God has already said in His Word. You see, it's important to take with you in prayer the Word of God. It's important for you to understand that when you pray, it's vital for you to understand that the Word of God is a necessary part of the prayer. Look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, and I want to show you what this means. So prayer is literally saying to God what God has already said in His Word. And specifically for us, prayer is saying to God what God said in this new covenant of grace. Prayer is saying to God what God has already done and what He's already said. And so now watch this in verse 10. He says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might." Now notice, he didn't say be strong in your own strength. He said be strong where? In the Lord and in the power of His might. So we're trusting God for strength. We're trusting God for His might. Amen? And then look at verse 11. Verse 11 says this. He says, "Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles or the strategies or the tricks of the devil." Now, if you didn't know it, Satan has strategies designed against you. Satan has tricks designed against you. He has a strategy to kill, steal, and to destroy. He has a strategy to wipe you out. He has a strategy to try to get you to not stand on God's word. You see, spiritual warfare is not you trying to put the devil in a headlock. Spiritual warfare is simply maintaining your stance on the finished works of Jesus Christ. Spiritual warfare is you and me obtaining, listen, maintaining what Jesus has obtained. What did Jesus obtain? The victory. He obtained healing, deliverance, all the finished works of Jesus. He died on the cross to obtain the victory. Our job in spiritual warfare is to maintain our stance in confidence of what Jesus died to obtain. So we don't pray for victory. We've already obtained victory. Our job is to maintain victory. We pray from victory. We don't pray for victory, but we pray from the position of victory. Amen? So if Jesus died to obtain your healing, then you believe right now you're already healed, right? So now spiritual warfare is you standing on the healing, maintaining your stance on healing regardless of what's going on. Now the devil's job is to come up with strategies to try to move you off of that stance. His job is to use your circumstances and situations to try to remove you from that stance. If he can remove you from that stance, then he's winning in spiritual warfare. But when he comes with different strategy to try to get you off of the victory that Jesus has already obtained from you, and you maintain your stance no matter what, he's losing. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to announce in this church, the devil's losing. Amen. We are maintaining our stance in the victory that Jesus has already died for. Amen. So we're fighting this spiritual warfare. We're fighting against the strategies of the enemy. The enemy wants to kill you. He is not your friend. He doesn't have mercy. He's not trying to not embarrass you. He's trying to destroy you. He kills, steals, and destroys. But the way you defeat him is by, first of all, knowing what Jesus has already done, and secondly, maintaining your stance and confidence on what he has done. And no matter what the devil comes with, you come with a bill, you say, "I still believe I'm prosperous." You come with a bad report about my health, "Oh, I'm healed in Jesus' name." You come with trying to depress me, "I have the joy of the Lord." Every time you do that, you are winning in this spiritual warfare by maintaining your stance. If you understand that, say amen. All right, now who are we fighting? Again, verse 12, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood." So your enemy is not your coworker. Your enemy is not a relative who didn't give you your $20 back. Your enemy, the Bible says, you are wrestling against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness in this world, and against spiritual wickedness in high places. So notice your enemy, they are levels of demons, demonic forces. levels of demonic forces. Now, a lot of people, well, I don't believe in demonic forces. There are demons and there are angels. There is a heaven, there is a hell. Do not allow yourself to believe or not believe based on what you've seen with these two eyes. There are spiritual forces that are working against you. Sometimes the bad attitude, or you've lost a temper, or some weird thing that you've done. Those are all being influenced by demonic forces. Drug addiction, the Bible has a Greek word for that, that we're the same word we get pharmaceuticals from, pharmacia. And it's a type of class of demons that attack in that area. A lot of people hadn't heard or received teaching on this, but demons are doing everything they can to destroy your life. And so he says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against these demonic forces trying to stop you. Now, I declare right now, they won't be able to stop you. Why? Because you are not fighting for victory, you are fighting from victory. Your victory has already been obtained. And as Christians, all you need to do is stand on the finished works of Jesus Christ. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, keep standing. So he says, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. So he says, now here's the key to defeating these forces. Take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. Now, how many of you know everybody has an evil day? Your evil day may not be my evil day. My evil day may not be your evil day, but everybody's going to have an evil day. And that's why you get up every day and declare, Father, I thank you that I'm delivered from the evil of this day. Every day you get up and you declare, I dwell in the secret place of the Most High. I abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I say of the Lord, you are my fortress. You're my high tower. You're the God in whom I trust. Amen. Just because there's going to be an evil day doesn't mean you have to be overcome by the evil day. Amen. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, what else do you do? Having done all to stand, verse 14 says what? Stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness. Now notice, the key to winning in this battle is putting on the whole armor of God. Now I'm going to tell you right now, the armor of God is the Word of God. The armor of God, when you put on the Word of God and you keep that Word in your mind, keep it through your eyes, keep it through your ears, keep it in your heart, that's the whole fight. The devil's got to try to deceive you into thinking something that God's Word didn't say. But when you equip yourself with the Word, it's difficult for you to lose a battle when you know that you know that you know. So the devil is destroying people by keeping them ignorant of God's Word. And if he can keep you ignorant of God's Word, keep you out of churches that teach the Word of God, if he can do that, then he will keep your minds blind. And the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 4:4 that Satan wants to keep the minds of those who don't believe blind so that the gospel of this light of the gospel won't come under you. But if you get in the Word and keep getting in the Word and keep that Word in you and you get in that Word, it's going to be very difficult for you to lose any battle because you have the truth. The armor of God is the truth of God's Word. Amen. Now watch this. He said, and your feet shod with the preparation of, watch this, the gospel of peace. Verse 16, he says, above all, taking the shield of faith. He says, above everything, take the shield of faith. Now, what is that? The shield of faith is what you hold up when Satan comes to try to deceive you with words or different things. So, you know, you say, I'm healed. And then Satan says, no, you're not. You're going to be dead. Hold the shield of faith up and say, I'm healed. And that dart will go in that shield. You say, I'm prosperous. And Satan said, no, you're broken. You'll be broke all your life. Hold the shield of faith up and say, I'm prosperous. And that dart will go into that shield. That's why he says, above everything, take the shield of faith. So every time the devil speaks or says anything that's not lined up with the Word, and think about it, he ain't going to say nothing that's in line with the Word. So every time he speaks, hold up the shield of faith. Don't fuss with him. Don't argue with him. Hold up the shield of faith. So if he comes and say you're going to die, hold the shield of faith up and say, I will live and not die. If he comes to say you're going to die of this cancer, say, no, I'm already healed. If he comes and say you'll be broke all your life, no, God has prospered me, and I will prosper in every way. See, you have to know how to hold a shield up when the dart comes. Because if the dark comes and you don't hold a shield of faith up, then that has the potential of entering into your mind and entering into your thinking. And before long, you'll start believing what you heard him say about you. Above all, take the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. Verse 17, he says, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the what? Which is the word of God. And what do you do with the word of God? Verse 18, he says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So notice what he says to take with you when you pray. Take what with you when you pray? Take what with you when you pray? Take what with you when you pray? So prayer is taking the word and saying to God what he said in his word. How does that work? Well, let's say, again, on healing. And let's say, you know, you find a scripture and it says in the word, with his stripes you are healed. And so you want to go and pray that. You say, Father, I thank you that your word says that I am healed. And I believe, I receive, I am healed. Thank you for healing me 2,000 years ago. Thank you, Lord, that I am healed. See, you're praying the word. And he says, when you take the word with you in prayer, and especially the word of grace, you're always going to be praying about what he's already done. And that's New Testament praying. I am going to pray about what has already been done. One prayer that God will not answer. He will not answer a prayer where you ask him to do what he has already done. It's not going to happen. He's not going to answer a prayer where you're praying about something that he has already taken care of. Oh, God, please heal me. He says, I already healed you. Receive it. Oh, deliver me. I've already delivered you. Receive it. God, give me a job. I've already provided that too. Receive it. So how do I pray that? I go before God and I say, Lord, you know, your word says you've supplied all of my need. And right now, a job is a need. So I believe I receive the job that you've already supplied in Jesus' name. Yeah. You follow what I'm saying? Take the word with you when you pray. Amen. Now, I want to share with you the fact that as I begin to look through the New Testament, I found things like prayer giving birth to favor, prayer giving birth to healing. It's not really prayer giving birth, but remember, prayer is the bridge that allows the manifestations of God's finished works to travel into your life. Prayer, a bridge. Picture that. It's just a bridge to allow the travel to reach you. It's God's, it's you giving heaven a permit to allow what has already been done to reach you in manifestation. Permit. Somebody say permit. How many of you know it would be illegal if God would do something without a permit? You got to have a permit. And he's waiting on you to give a permit. And that's why prayer is so important. Will you give him a permit to heal you? Will you give him a permit to deliver you? Will you give him a permit to favor you? There's a permit that comes when you begin to go before God and pray. So let's look at just a few scriptures of people praying, giving heaven a permit, and as a result of it, it shows up. Look at 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and 11. There's some people that got together to pray, and as a result of it, the blessing of the Lord showed up. 2 Corinthians 1 and 11, I'm going to read out of the Amplified. He says, while you also cooperate by your prayers for us, helping and laboring together with us. Look at there, when you're praying, you're helping. I say when you're praying, you're helping. World changes help us pray. When you're praying, you're helping. He says, you're praying and laboring together with us. Thus the lips of many persons turned towards God will eventually give thanks on our behalf for the grace, the blessing of deliverance will be granted us at the request of many who have prayed. I tell you, I believe there's something happens when many people get together and pray. But notice he says the blessing of grace shows up when you pray. Notice grace and favor can show up manifested in your life when you pray. Now, That may sound like, well, Brother Dollar, that seems like we got to pray first and then what God does. No. God has already done what he's doing. Now you've got to be in a receiving mode. And the way you receive it is to say, Father, I so believe what you've done that I'm going to go ahead and pray and give permit for this thing to be manifested in my life. How many of y'all ready to receive some manifestation in your life? I don't believe we're understanding the grace of God just to talk about the grace of God, but to see the manifestation of the grace of God in our lives. Amen. Look at this next scripture in James chapter 5, verse 13. James chapter 5, verse 13, you begin to see healing and great power showing up as a result of prayer. Prayer now is allowing this to be manifested. James chapter 5, verse 13, is any among you afflicted? He says, well, how do you handle somebody that's afflicted? He said, pray, give a permit so we can handle that affliction. Is any merry? Let him sing. Psalms, verse 14. He says, is any sick among you? He said, let him call for the elders of the church and let them do what? Pray. In every situation, whatever the situation is, they're giving heaven a permit so something can happen. Then he says, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Look at verse 15. He says, and the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith is just simply you praying like you already know it's done. The prayer of faith shall do what? Save the sick, and the Lord shall raise them up, and if any have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Look at 16. He says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another. Now that, you know, confess your faults one to another, that's not going and telling people stuff and so they can put you on blast later. The purpose is I'm going to confess my faults to you so you can remind me that I'm the righteousness of God. So you can remind me that Jesus has given me eternal forgiveness. So you can remind me not to beat myself up and to condemn myself. Ladies and gentlemen, when somebody gets transparent enough with you to tell you their faults, that's not for you to pick the phone up and gossip it with somebody else. It's for you to remind them, you all right, baby, Jesus died for that fault. The blood has taken care of that. All is well with you. You are the righteousness of God. That's what that's for. Confess your faults one to another. Pray for one another that you may be what? Healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now look at that last verse 16 in the Amplified Bible. Look at what happens. You are praying. You are giving heaven permission or permit. You're giving heaven permission. That sounds strange to a religious ear. How am I giving heaven permission? Well, remember, he gave you authority. He gave you authority over everything. And right now he's saying, I need your permission. I need a permit from you. Glory be to God. Say this out loud. Nothing just happens. All right, watch this, verse 16, Amplified. Confess to one another, therefore, your faults, your slips, your false steps, your offenses, your sins, and pray also for one another that you may be what?
Healed.
See, I've already prayed, and today, many of you will be healed. Matthew 10 and 8 says, heal people, bring healing to them. I'm gonna pray to give heaven a permit, and then I'm gonna lay hands on you in the name of Jesus, and you're gonna be healed. It's just that simple.
Get ready to experience extraordinary results when you pray. In Creflo Dollar's enlightening three-part series, The Power of Grace-Based Prayer, you'll learn how to command healing and victory for yourself and others. Contact us now and you'll also receive Understanding the Holy Spirit Within You, a three-part series that reveals the power of speaking in tongues, along with this special DVD, The Results of Prayer Testimonials, featuring unforgettable stories of triumph, all for a love gift of $50 or more. Contact us